Our world is undergoing profound change. Science and technology are transforming our lives with dizzying speed. Astonishing innovations are ushering in a new era of opportunity. The high-tech revolution is fueling creativity around the globe, inspiring visionary solutions. So open your eyes and get ready for an amazing journey to 2050 to dream the future. Eternal life is the ultimate dream of mankind. Most of us will settle for protecting our health and our loved ones. To live long and to live well, that's the goal of medicine.
One of the major goals of the field, of course, is to improve patients' lives.
Soon, 2 billion people will be over 60.
Today, people do live longer, but not always in good health. The number of supercentenarians, people who live to 110, hasn't skyrocketed.
People want to make the most of life, their youth, their good health. And that's it. It's become an obsession.
The medicine of the future could be miraculous. Will it develop superdrugs capable of wiping out terminal illnesses? Predict our destinies from birth.
Only seconds old, the exact time and cause of my death was already known.
I was born February 9th, 1975.
So, I guess it must be your birthday.
Preventing and curing diseases, repairing our bodies and carrying on stronger than ever. Those are the challenges for 2050. Dreamers from around the world are inventing the medicine of the future.
I wish the doctors would find out that how to grow back a leg. That would be a great future. That you would get these, I don't know, like salamander or something that grow back the tails.
My dream for 2050 is to build a medical industry in Africa in order to improve living conditions and patient monitoring across the continent.
I asked myself, what good is it to develop technologies if we don't use them to address humankind's most important problems?
And ideally, we'll be able to produce human organs and human tissue.
Just as the 20th century was dominated by the development of electronics and computer science, the 21st century will be dominated by biology.
These visionaries follow in the footsteps of those who have dreamed of protecting our health. Humans have always fought diseases, seeking remedies in nature. More than 3,600 years ago, the Egyptian Imhotep developed the art of closing wounds. But they also wanted to understand diseases. Hippocrates, then Galen, and finally Avicenna developed Western medicine. They listed illnesses and devised cures, struggling to understand the human body and its malfunctions. Some dreamed of reaching inside the human body. In the 19th century, the French physician Laennec invented the stethoscope. In 1895, Wilhelm Conrad Röntgen discovered the X-ray, ushering in the era of medical imaging. Scientists began looking for the origin of diseases at the microscopic level. Louis Pasteur discovered the role of microorganisms in infectious diseases. In 1928, Alexander Fleming discovered penicillin, the beginning of antibiotics. We dreamed of replacing body parts. 1967 saw the first successful heart transplant. James Watson and Francis Crick discovered the structure of DNA. In 2001, the human genome was decoded, setting the stage for repairing human genes directly. Medicine has become increasingly efficient. What will it be like tomorrow?
In the future, medicine will use technological advances which are quickly emerging. Its main goals will be to detect illnesses sooner, personalize treatment to minimize side effects, and integrate patient complexity. It will be targeted, customized, digital, and molecular.
In public transportation, at home, or at work, communication technologies are everywhere. We're constantly connected through smartphones and computers. By 2050, digital technology will transform our health. An increasing number of watches, bracelets, and toothbrushes are already connected to the web, monitoring our body in real time. Heart rate, body mass index, blood pressure. Our daily activities are now scrutinized and analyzed. These connected objects will change the face of medicine, helping to save lives in the poorest and most isolated parts of the world. In 2050, connected healthcare could put an end to medical deserts. In Cameroon, a young engineer is leading the way. He developed an innovative system for diagnosis and therapeutic monitoring.
It all started out of curiosity. In the beginning, I was intrigued by the way medical devices worked. In the field of cardiology, for instance, the ECG device is very impressive because it produces tracings that only doctors can understand. The Cardiopad project began in 2009. Back then, I was studying computer science at the École Polytechnique in Yaoundé, and I started developing medical software programs. Then I realized there was a shortage of cardiologists in the country. Currently, there are about 50 or 55 for 20 million people. The consequences are disastrous. It forces patients living in villages to travel every time they need medical exams. It's more difficult, more expensive, and more time-consuming. In remote areas, fewer people will do those tests, which can lead to an increase in mortality due to cardiovascular diseases. In 2014, we launched the pilot phase of the project. We chose two hospitals, which we equipped with our devices free of charge, one in a village and the other in a city. The devices are currently used and cardiac exams are performed in the village hospital.
Gerbana, come on in.
The cardiopad is fitted with a GSM, GPRS, or 3G modem, and can send the data to a distant server. The results are transferred from the village to the city, where they will be interpreted by a cardiologist. The device will identify each heartbeat as normal or abnormal. According to the percentage of normal heartbeats, the tablet will make an initial diagnosis, which will be confirmed or ruled out by the cardiologist. We will then be able to tell patients what they're suffering from and how to proceed. The pilot phase has been very useful because it has allowed us to collect doctors' feedback in order to improve the device. We've added many features over time to integrate all the parameters needed for an accurate interpretation. We're currently working on a project to develop devices for personal use. It would enable us to transfer the results directly from the patient's home to the cardiologist. For me, the healthcare of the future in Africa should be accessible, widespread, and much more affordable. This starts with the development of a growing number of low-cost devices using fairly efficient technologies, which are accessible to district hospitals, or with a direct connection between patients at home and the specialists who treat them. My dream for 2050 is to build a medical industry in Africa, that is, a group of companies mass-producing low-cost medical devices in order to improve living conditions and patient monitoring across the continent.
Linking to a healthcare network seems like a great solution for the future. But where would doctors fit in?
Their role will clearly evolve. First of all, they will have to master the technology. When doctors prescribe drugs, they must be aware of side effects and malfunctions. Likewise, when there's a technological malfunction, they will be responsible for the device. They will have to learn how to use it and explain how it works to the patient. Hospitals will also evolve. Their role will be to manage digital communication infrastructures and to store data. And new jobs will start to appear, new types of health professionals for a more customized digital healthcare.
Digital monitoring will flood the internet with sensitive personal data. Family history, surgeries, chronic diseases are most intimate medical details.
Will the data collected actually enable patients to improve their health through better prevention or disease management? Or will it mostly benefit insurance companies, which will adjust rates and coverage accordingly?
The confidentiality of our medical information is a major issue. But the integrated data also opens the way to a new kind of healing. Each doctor will have permanent access to our whole medical and biological history. This could improve the speed and accuracy of diagnosis. Medical imaging is another key tool. It has made dramatic progress and can already detect minute tumors. And thanks to 3D body scanning, everyone will have a digital self by 2050. Real-time medical imaging serves as a comprehensive tool for doctors and a crucial one for surgeons.
We can expect to see far more detailed imaging in the future. Surgeons will be able to see veins, arteries, and nerves invisible to the naked eye. They will be able to see cells. It's extraordinary to think that thanks to confocal microscopy, surgeons will have the ability to see cells measuring 200 microns in diameter. It used to be unimaginable. And then they will see the invisible. Thanks to advanced fluorescence techniques, they will be able to see blood flow or visualize vascularization of an intestine before cutting or suturing it.
In 2050, there will be no more lengthy medical exams and long waits for results. We will have access to labs on a chip, miniaturized laboratories that swiftly make precise diagnoses. That's precisely what engineer Luc Gervais is developing in Switzerland. His microfluidic chip promises a revolution in medical analysis, similar to the invention of microprocessors.
Just as the 20th century was dominated by physics, the invention of the transistor, the development of electronics and computer science, many say that the 21st century will be dominated by biology. My father's always been passionate about computers. When I was in high school, I used to program my graphing calculator. I worked on computers a lot, even before I took a programming class. One-drop diagnostic is a company developing a new kind of medical diagnosis, a device capable of detecting several diseases from a single drop of blood in less than 10 minutes. The lab on a chip is made of two main components, a disposable microfluidic chip and a reusable tablet. It's very easy to use. First, I prick my finger, and then I place a drop of blood on the chip. One drop of blood contains millions of cells, platelets, red blood cells, white blood cells, but also thousands of trillions of proteins, nucleic acids, and tiny molecules. The microfluidic chip will filter the blood out and analyze the plasma, which contains biomarkers linked to specific diseases. Several biomarkers have already been identified for cancer or cardiovascular diseases. Blood sugar levels can be used for diabetes. Doctors will interpret the concentration of these biomarkers to detect a potential disease in a patient. I thought of several features we could integrate into the chip that would be innovative, revolutionary even, with respect to medical diagnosis. So I started putting these ideas on paper and developing the technology. The first microfluidic chip was developed in 2012, along with the first prototypes. We then adjusted the design to improve the chip's performance. Imagine the biomarkers in the blood sample as keys and the microfluidic chip as being full of locks. Certain biochemical reagents inside the chip detect the biomarkers. It works like a lock and key. The reagents are very specific. Only one key will fit into the lock. With medical diagnoses, time can make the difference between life and death. The quicker we can diagnose a heart attack, the quicker we'll be able to give the right treatment and save the patient's life. This device can detect hundreds of illnesses, cancers, for instance, and infectious diseases such as the flu, HIV, or hepatitis, even allergies. It can also monitor liver or thyroid functions. One of the main benefits of this technology is that it reduces costs drastically. The medical diagnosis is much cheaper than with automated analyzers. It will enable physicians to diagnose poor people in developing countries. I imagine that by 2050, this device will be available everywhere, and that patients will be able to use it at home, at the doctor's office, or at the pharmacy. My dream is that biology becomes a data-driven science, and that we eventually know everything about the human body, the same way we understand everything about a microchip. I hope we'll be able to efficiently diagnose illnesses, to provide a treatment based on that diagnosis, and to treat all diseases currently afflicting humankind.
Medical microchips will save lives, as biological analysis detects diseases far earlier than other methods.
In 2050, we will subscribe to our daily health newsletter, just as we check the weather forecast every morning.
So wouldn't it be great if we can actually detect heart disease way before it gets serious, and to be able to heal it at that time before it gets to be chronic?
Being able to detect diseases before they take hold, will this be our reality in 2050? Some are betting on decoding the human genome to prevent and even predict diseases. They believe analysis of our DNA could reveal our predisposition to certain pathologies and even forecast our life expectancy.
Only seconds old, the exact time and cause of my death was already known.
Neurological condition, 60% probability. Manic depression, 42% probability. Attention deficit disorder, 89% probability. Heart disorder, 99% probability. Early fatal potential, life expectancy, 30.2 years.
The idea that you could predict every disease that will affect a patient from their genome sequence is completely illusory. We already know that it's a misconception. Our knowledge of the genome can predict and therefore prevent a few diseases, mostly very rare conditions. It can also predict intolerance to certain drugs. But these only represent a very small portion of medical procedures. The vast majority has to do with environmental factors, for which our knowledge of the genome won't be very informative.
But genetic analysis could play a major role in treatment. Detecting genetic defects allows personalized treatment for each and every one of us.
Targeted treatments use the individual characteristics of a patient. They target molecular characteristics specific to their pathology.
In Paris, a team of young researchers is designing the drugs of the future. Their goal is a groundbreaking antibiotic suitable for everyone.
I've always wanted to do research. When I was 12, I met a researcher who loved genetics. He was a French pioneer in that field and passed his passion on to me. I specialized in that discipline, but after a while, I asked myself, what good is it to develop technologies if we don't use them to address humankind's biggest problems? The human body contains more than 10,000 trillion bacteria, whether on our skin, in our lungs, or in our intestines. They're called commensal bacteria and are, for the most part, essential for the proper and healthy functioning of the body. Current antibiotics are like weapons of mass destruction, killing all bacteria, good and bad. This is a major cause of antibiotic resistance. Antibiotic resistance has been dubbed one of the biggest scourges of the 21st century. By 2050, according to the World Health Organization, the primary cause of death in the world will be infections caused by antibiotic-resistant bacteria. If we don't design medication now to prevent those multi-drug-resistant bacteria from developing and spreading across the globe, we won't dare perform surgery on a patient for a prosthesis or a wisdom tooth due to the high risk of infection by these bacteria that can't be killed. Here at Eligo Bioscience, we're designing smart antibiotics. We call them eligobiotics from the Latin eligo, which means to select. They can selectively eradicate harmful bacteria while sparing the beneficial ones present in our body, on the skin, or in the intestines.
Smart antibiotics are a game changer.
In order to fight these resistant bacteria, we are using a system called CRISPR, molecular scissors that cut the DNA of resistant and virulent bacteria. To deliver these molecular scissors among the bacteria in our body, we will actually use a virus that attacks them, which we are able to reprogram in order to inject our DNA scissors. One of the strengths of the CRISPR system is that it can specifically cut the DNA of harmful bacteria, thereby killing them. We need to know exactly which bacteria are making us sick in order to destroy them. This strategy will therefore be part of a personalized healthcare program. The diagnosis will reveal precisely what kind of bacteria are harmful, and then the eligobiotic will target them.
We have already demonstrated in vivo proof of concept on mice. We were able to achieve decolonization of antibiotic-resistant Staphylococcus aureus, which has already killed human patients. In 2050, medicine will be much more preventive. Thanks to the development of new technologies, we'll be able to diagnose the cause of illnesses. Within that framework, eligobiotics will make even more sense, because we'll be able to eradicate the few bacteria responsible for numerous pathologies long before they multiply and cause symptoms.
As medicine becomes more preventive, could we imagine never getting sick again?
In the future, we will combine our knowledge of the physiology of the system we want to target with the various tools we'll have at our disposal. Treatments will not consist of one molecule for one target, or the same molecule for everyone. We'll use combinations adapted to each individual situation.
In 2050, we'll be able to regenerate organs.
Regenerative medicine aims at replacing cells, organs, or functions that have been damaged or destroyed.
Geneticists are reprogramming cells to turn them into livers, hearts, and skin.
I don't think the promise of regenerative medicine by 2050 is in the realm of science fiction. There will be major breakthroughs, such as the use of nanomaterials, which, injected into organs, will stimulate stem cells, or the ability to 3D print living cells to rebuild and replace organs.
Our hope for the future, in terms of its potential, is to be able to heal more organs and to help to restore more patients back to their normal health using these technologies.
Crazy as it sounds, our failing bodies will one day be repaired with custom-made organs from a 3D printer. Swedish researchers at Chalmers University are firm believers. They're creating a bio-ink that makes printing organs possible.
I always considered myself as a revolutionary person who've always tried to differentiate myself. Me and my team, Hector and Ida, we are innovators at the edge of the regenerative medicine. And ideally, we'll be able to produce human organs and human tissue. My first interaction with bioprinting was here in Sweden. And I made a visit to my father's lab at Chalmers University. And they had just acquired a bioprinter. And I came into the lab and, you know, I still remember the days. I walked in and I saw this new equipment. It's just standing on the bench. And you could see the fact that this could potentially print life. And you get this idea of what could be possible with this technology. We are experts in the field of bioprinting human tissue, human organs, and tissue models. The company was started as a biomaterials company focusing on producing the bio-ink for bioprinters. And the bio-ink is basically the ink that you put into a paper printer, for instance, for that example, or the plastic filament into 3D printers. So we produce that filament, the bio-ink. Our biomaterial cell ink is based on very natural components, and it contains about 80 to 90% water. This means that this produces an ideal environment for cells to survive, but also to feel like home. They feel like they're inside the human being. We've actually developed a tool, which we call the cell mixer. It's a device that allows you to mix the human cells together with the cell ink biomaterial. It's a two-compartment, two-syringe system where you have one syringe with the human cells in suspension and one syringe with the bio-ink, the cell ink material. And then you mix them together and create a cocktail or a mixture of basically living material to print with. Idea behind this is really to produce human body parts and organs. And then for that fact to be true, you obviously have to produce them in the shape that they should look. So an ear, for instance, must look like an ear.
Printing today?
So for instance, let's say that we would like to print a patient's own ear. We take a picture of the existing ear, make a replica in a computer model, and then send that file to our software and then to the printer. And then the printer can print out the actual patient's ear in full structure and full detail. And that's the concept behind it. And this will be able to be done with every single organ and body part inside the human being. We've worked for several months in terms of developing cartilage models, and currently we're also developing skin tissue models and developing a bio-ink and biomaterial that's specific for skin tissue applications. Next step will be to develop a bio-ink specific for kidney tissue, and then in the future possibly for liver and other organs. What drives and motivates me behind this company is the ability to make change, and make change in regenerative medicine, and make change for the populations and the future of human beings. We have the opportunity to change the way the world works, and that is at the core my true understanding of what I want to do. In the future, we will be able to print out human organs and human body parts straight in the operating room and implant them directly into the patient.
By 2050, will scientists have overcome the last hurdles left to recreate hearts, livers, and kidneys?
One of the challenges for solid organs is the vascularity, the ability of these organs to survive long term with enough nutrition. Currently, using our bioprinting strategies, we are creating miniature solid organs like kidney, lung, heart, but these are miniature organs. What we're working on over the next few years is how can we take these miniature organs and make them larger so we can implant them back into patients.
These organs will be implanted into the patient in the operating room of the future, where robots and surgeons work hand in hand.
One can imagine that by 2050, surgery will be automated. By automated, I mean actual robotic surgery. The operation will be performed by a robot, while a surgeon simply oversees the process. He can press a button to stop the operation if something unexpected happened.
Can we imagine wiping away the consequences of a major accident or a defect? Will disabled people regain mobility and feeling thanks to prosthetics packed with microprocessors and perfectly suited to the body? In Reykjavik, Iceland, one company specializes in smart prosthetics for the lower limbs. To keep improving their bionic products, innovators team up with amputees, such as in-house engineer David Johnson and Olympic javelin champion Helgi Svensson.
The technology in the last 10 to 15 years has evolved very quickly. And we can now demonstrate that it's not only a question of putting a peg leg under people, it's much more a question about restoring their overall lifestyle and providing a life without limitation to amputees as well. Most prosthetic products right now are only a mechanical device that rely on very, very simple mechanical mechanism in order to mostly just generate a bit of motion during swing phase, to like when your leg clears the ground, and then has a very, very simple braking system just to prevent it from buckling when you put weight on it. The latest innovation that we've been working on for lower limb prosthetic technology at Össur are a lot related in making leg prosthesis or knee prosthesis much more convivial for use by the typical amputee. Because the modern prosthetic device has a computer directly embedded in the device, then it's possible to implement artificial intelligence algorithms and embedded sensors that would actually measure either speeds or accelerations or loads in order to make a decision or an informed decision on what the user is trying to do and what is the most appropriate behavior for the prosthetic device to implement in order to properly support the task at hand. The device will recognize that he's actually switching to running and will automatically and instantly adjust its behavior to better support the running task. For sure, one of the major next steps we're foreseeing for evolution of the prosthetic or lower limb prosthetic technology is to be able to close that gap between controlling the prosthetic device and the user intent. So the future technology will actually allow us to use sensors that would directly connect to a remaining physiological structure like muscles or like nerves, and allow us to actually get the signal directly as it is issued from the peripheral nervous system or the arc reflex loop. Currently, we've been running proof of concept work or very early research with this type of technology by putting implanted sensor in the residual limb of transtibial and transfemoral amputee, and that measure actually the muscle electrical activity. The sensor itself then like communicates this information through a wireless system to the embedded computer in the prosthetic.
Disabled since childhood, Gummy Olafsson has tested the latest prototype, which he can control with his mind.
I run, I walk, I swim, I scuba dive, I snorkel, I go up mountains, I go hiking, I have a dog that I go out. I walk about 15 kilometers every day. Before, I walked 200 yards. Before I lost my leg, so my life is much better than before. So that's basically what, you know, what drives me on. I got into an accident when I was 9 years old. I got hit by an oil truck. For 28 years, I kept the foot. And in January 2004, I got amputated. What I got is a sensor in my legs. And I can move that foot with my muscles. Yeah. Well, basically, my mind tells my muscle to move the foot, and it does. And that's one of the, well, it's still a prototype, but oh my God, that's a great foot.
So that's something.
When I got it the first time, I started to cry. Because I was moving my ankle for the first time in 11 years. And I wouldn't be able to move my ankle. All of a sudden, my mind was telling my ankle to come up or going down, and I could do it. And it was just overwhelming. And that was an amazing feeling. I still think about it backwards, and it gives me a smile on my face. I haven't used my muscles for so long.
It's going.
When I start to use my foot, I always have to think, basically, first. Always, oh, yeah, I have to move it like this, or I have to move it like this. It's natural for me. You still have to think a little bit, but it's always getting less and less more, you know. When I'm walking upstairs, I just lift up the toe. I really don't think about it anymore. It just happens. 2050, that is in 40 odd years. I wish the doctors would find out that how to grow back a leg. That would be a great future, that you would get these, I don't know, like salamander or something that grow back the tails, that you could grow back your leg. But don't think, but that would be a great future. If they can't, you always have to have a prosthetic leg. To attach it to your body, then you would have feelings for it. That would be a great idea. That you could wiggle your toes. That would be even greater idea.
Restoring sensation is the final frontier for prosthetics. By 2050, will artificial skin, equipped with sensors, conquer this obstacle? Reality is catching up with fiction.
The prospect of fixing patients with smart prosthetics is an exciting one for doctors because, unfortunately, we're still too often confronted with diseases which destroy organs or functions and leave patients disabled. Our hope is to be able to overcome disabilities as seamlessly as possible.
Future prosthetics, ever more connected to the body, will blur boundaries with flesh and bone. This vision could tempt us to augment the human body.
The idea of the augmented man has always fascinated me. It's about prosthetics, extensions, the extension of the brain, of intelligence. We're in a field of action, of investigation, a kind of laboratory. And obviously, imagination has no limits.
From a repaired human to the bionic man. Some dream of a hybrid creature, all but immortal, who would finally rid us of this aging body.
The vision of a man-machine whose parts will be replaced when he's sick, like a car, is obviously a very reductionist one, which doesn't consider what medicine truly is. A sick person is anything but a car.
Immortality is seductive. But isn't imperfection the essence of man? Someone who creates, who loves, and passes away.
Medicine's big challenge is to enable people that are temporarily taken out of society by disease to get back into it and regain their humanity through interactions with their loved ones, their co-workers, and the society in which they'll reveal their talents.
As the medicine of 2050 aims to cure us, one can dream that even preventive, targeted, and personalized, it will keep a human face.